Thank you. I think we'll move on directly to the next item of business, which is portfolio questions. And the first portfolio this afternoon is health and social care. And if a member would wish to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter R in the chat function during the relevant question. I call question number one, Mercedes Villalba.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact assessments it has made of any increased use of online appointments on patients' access to GP services.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Near me is a safe and secure NHS video consulting service that enables people to attend appointments from home or wherever, of course, is convenient. During the pandemic, the use of Near Me in Scotland rose from around about 1,000 consultations per month to a peak of 90,000 per month. GP consultations are included in these totals. Usage is currently 50,000 consultations a month. To answer your question directly, the Scottish Government has published its impact assessment of Near Me, and that is available. If the member hasn't seen it, I'm happy to send the link across to her. GP practices, of course, are ultimately responsible for ensuring that their local appointments arrangements, online or otherwise, meet their patients' needs and provide satisfactory access.
Mercedes Villalba.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. In the face of opposition from patients and staff, Old Aberdeen Medical Practice was put out to tender, and this has resulted in declining standards of patient care for many of my constituents. One example of this is the rollout of an e-consult system to arrange GP appointments online. It should have allowed patients to request an appointment at any time, but in reality, it's left many struggling to access the care that they need, including one constituent who contacted me when she was 30 weeks pregnant and unable to get an appointment through the e-consult system. It's an unacceptable deterioration.
Could we have a question, please,
of what was once a highly effective and popular practice. Will the Minister commit today to undertaking an impact assessment of the e-consult system and how it has affected the provision and quality of patient care at Old Aberdeen?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will certainly look at that suggestion with an open mind, because I do know about the e-consult system, and I'm disappointed to hear the feedback that Ms Villalba's constituents are giving her. So I will look at this issue into more detail. The NHS Grampian, as you know, has provided their GP practices with that e-consult system. It is meant to help doctors prioritise who needs face-to-face help and who, for example, can have help over the telephone or through video consultation. Patients can access e-consult at any time, even outside of surgery hours. But notwithstanding all of that, I hear the concerns raised by Mercedes Villalba, and of course I will give serious consideration to her suggestion, but in the meantime I will take it up both with the Health and Social Care Partnership and the Health Board.
And supplementary, Sandesh Gohani, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you. GPs are holding more consultations than before the pandemic, but demand is such that patients do not feel they are being seen in the manner they would like. What new measures will the Scottish Government do to support GP practices under unsustainable pressure and better communicate with patients via possibly a campaign that GPs are open for business and explain the different appointment types available?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we're doing a lot to support GPs, including, of course, increasing funding this financial year. But also, I think communication and messaging is really, really important. We have made sure that we are saying quite clearly to people that, of course, we want to increase the number of face-to-face appointments, and working with the BMA, the Royal College of GPs, in that respect. But also this unfair vilification of GPs and GP staff, including receptionists, really must stop, which is coming from some quarters, frankly, from some quarters in the UK government, as well as some quarters even in this chamber here. So yes, let's support patients to increase the number of face-to-face patients, but let's make sure that access to GPs is part of a hybrid system that includes online, includes video consultation, telephone consultation, as well as face-to-face consultation too.
Question number two, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how much it will spend per head of population and health in the current financial year.
Cabinet Secretary.
£18 billion is provided for health and social care in 2022-23, this financial year. This takes forward our commitment to increase spending on the NHS by 20%, over £2.5 billion by the end of this Parliament, and builds on our frontline spending that is £111 per person higher in Scotland than it is in England. To put that into context, that is over £600 million more proportionately.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and thank you for making that comparison. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could also set out the elements in the social contract that residents in Scotland benefit from that are not available elsewhere.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think that is an important question, because on top of that higher spending per head than in England, and indeed I should say it's £146 higher than in Wales, we know that people in Scotland, of course, also get access to free medicine. We've abolished prescription charges. I think the fee in England at the moment is well above £9 per item. We've abolished NHS hospital car parking charges, saving users over £60 million, provide free dental care for everybody who is under 26, and we're the only UK nation to provide free universal NHS-funded eye examinations. So I'm proud of our record on our NHS, not just the proportionate spend per head, but also all those additional benefits that are enjoyed here in Scotland that aren't enjoyed in other parts of the UK.
Supplementary, Douglas Ross.
Deputy Presiding Officer, spending our NHS is absolutely crucial, but so are actions. The Cabinet Secretary will be well aware that Murray's maternity service was temporarily downgraded for up to 12 months in 2018. The Chief Executive of NHS Grampian has now said it could be a further decade before those services are returned. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with that timescale? Does he agree it's unacceptable? And what is he going to do to speed that up?
Cabinet Secretary.
What can I say is, as Douglas Ross well knows, because I've met with him, I've met with campaigners locally, I've met with clinicians and Dr Grace as well as, of course, in Raigmore too, that this government has stated, I have stated, that we see Model 6 as that end destination. I have committed to a timetable this summer for Model 4, which would be in the interim, and then a timetable later in the year to get towards Model 6. So I won't preempt those discussions that are ongoing, but both health boards, NHS Grampian and indeed NHS Highland, who are crucial to Model 4 and then on to Model 6, they both know very clearly that I expect urgency and pace, but also that we must do this in a way for the women involved and their unborn children that is safe and sustainable.
And supplementary, Jackie Bailey.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that from 2007 to 2010, the SNP government did not pass on the money they received from the then UK Labour government for the NHS. Had they done so, the NHS would have £1 billion more today to spend on helping our hard-working NHS staff care for patients. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that his predecessor was right to divert money away from the NHS, given the challenges we face today?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Labour have a cheek to talk about health spending when they, of course, are the architects of PFI spend in our hospitals. The fact that, of course, this SNP government abolished car parking charges is something, of course, that I'm very, very proud of. If it was up to Labour and they were still in power, patients, staff, doctors, nurses would all have to be paying to park to go to their work. So I'm very proud of the fact that frontline health spending in Scotland is £146 higher than in Labour-controlled Wales.
Question number three, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on progress regarding the spring COVID-19 vaccination programme in NHS Lanarkshire area.
Cabinet Secretary.
NHS Lanarkshire have administered a fourth dose to over three quarters, 76%. Of all residents aged 75 and over as part of their spring COVID-19 vaccination programme. This includes over four in five, 82% of people aged 75 and over in NHS Lanarkshire who received their third dose more than 24 weeks ago. This demonstrates strong progress. It's very much in line with our expected delivery progress at this stage. Vaccine officials meet all NHS boards individually on a bi-weekly basis to cover performance and delivery and discuss whether any additional national programme support is required. Furthermore, future planning discussions are very much underway for future activity, including preparing for any possible future autumn-winter programme.
Claire Adamson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer and also thank the workers from NHS Lanarkshire who have been providing this service in the area. I was contacted by two of my Motherwell and Wishaw constituents who suffer from MS and chronic heart failure, respectively. Both are housebound, but have been refused the spring booster dose. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise on the best course of action for my constituents and others in this position who believe they may be eligible for the spring booster programme but have been unable to get the vaccine?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Claire Adamson for raising this issue, and she's welcome to give more details to me in writing if she wishes. The JCVI do advise that to be eligible for a spring booster, adults must be either aged 75 years and over, residents in care homes for older adults, or individuals 12 years or older who are immunosuppressed. And that definition of immunosuppression is taken from the appropriate chapter in the Green Book, Chapter 14A, and I'll send that detail across to her. And if her constituents are not eligible, therefore, because they do not fit that definition, there is some flexibility, clinical flexibility, in there. But, of course, that wouldn't be a decision for me to make, as she would know as a minister, but for clinicians and vaccination leads to make. We are waiting interim advice from the JCVI about a future programme, and for those that aren't eligible currently, they may well be eligible for a future autumn-winter programme. But that advice, I think the interim advice from the JCVI is due imminently.
A supplementary, Fergus Ewing.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that whether rural Scotland is located in North Lanarkshire or, for example, Nairn, that there is a shared desire for vaccination services to be provided locally? Building on the excellent and detailed work that the Cabinet Secretary has carried out with myself and Dr Baker of the Nairn Medical Practice, will he engage with NHS Highland to progress consideration of local GP practices that wish to do so, continuing to provide local vaccination services?
Cabinet Secretary, obviously a wee bit wider than North Lanarkshire, but I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary might want to take a stab at an answer.
An important issue raised by my colleague. I was delighted to meet with him and Dr Baker, very thoughtful and considered individual, both Mr Ewing and also Dr Baker, on the points about vaccination locally. What I would say is there is flexibility absolutely there. There is flexibility within the system. And in fact, there are parts of Scotland, if I think about Argyll and Bute, for example, where GP services are administering vaccinations in some parts of the country. So there is a degree of flexibility. I will raise that specific issue with NHS Highland.
Question number four, Brian Whittle, who's joining us remotely. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what actions it is taking to support people who are experiencing poor mental health as a result of long COVID.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The impact of the pandemic on our population has been far-reaching, and those who are suffering from long COVID should have access to the right mental health support at the right time. Our GPs and local healthcare teams are best placed to offer advice or treatment for mental health concerns, and they continue to work tirelessly to ensure that help and support is available to anyone who needs it. In addition, we have worked with NHS Inform to develop a dedicated long COVID website, which provides information and support in relation to low mood and depression and anxiety, with signposting to self-help guides. Underpinning the range of support available across the country and the Scottish Government's record funding for our NHS, including unprecedented investment for mental health services. Managing the mental health impacts of the pandemic remains an integral part of our plans. To refresh our mental health strategy, there will be an opportunity for us to consider how we improve existing support for people with long COVID and ensure that this support is consistently available across Scotland.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Long COVID is a serious issue in the aftermath of the pandemic, with tens of thousands of Scots estimated to be suffering. We should have had the opportunity to discuss this in a debate which was unfortunately postponed by the Scottish Government. So can I take the chance now to ask the Minister if he will ensure that in any response, when it does come from the Scottish Government, treatment for the potentially debilitating mental health aspect of long COVID is included?
Minister.
Of course, the mental health aspect should be included, and subject to Parliament's agreement, we intend to bring the long COVID debate back to Parliament on the 19th of May. This will allow ministers to provide a fuller update on progress, as we will not be bound by the pre-election period restrictions which we find ourselves in. So I am quite sure that Mr Whittle will be looking forward to that debate on the 19th of May.
A supplementary, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mental health is one of the major public health challenges in Scotland, and I'd like to put on the record my thanks to the NHS staff and the Scottish Government for ensuring that it's remained a priority throughout the response to COVID-19. Can I ask the Minister to provide an update on the increase in the number of mental health staff in Scotland since the SNP came into office and set out the action this government is taking to increase the number of mental health staff that will allow our patients to access support within their communities?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that the impact of the pandemic on the mental health of our population will be felt for years to come, and we are investing record levels of funding and expect total spend, including by NHS Scotland on mental health, to exceed £1.2 billion in the current financial year. And this funding will help services in all areas respond to the needs of the communities they support, including in the members' constituency. And I should say, in response to Ms Brown's question about staffing, since this government came to power in 2007, the mental health workforce has increased by, in psychology staff, for example, 95.6%, 34.7% rise in mental health nurses, a 21.6% rise in consultant psychiatrists, and an 83.4% rise of staff within children's and adult mental health services.
Question number five, Ruth Macquarie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to ensure that women who need it have access to specialist services for advice and support on the diagnosis and management of menopause.
Minister Marie Todd.
We are determined to ensure that women are able to access the care and support they need for menopause, be that through primary or specialist care. There's now a specialist menopause service in every mainland NHS board and support in place for the island health boards. A menopause specialist network meets regularly to provide consistent advice and peer support to healthcare professionals, including primary care teams. We know that many women will seek support from their local GP practice for their menopause symptoms. To support primary care, NHS Education for Scotland is developing menopause training for healthcare professionals, including practice nurses and GPs. And support for women experiencing the menopause will continue to be a priority for the Women's Health Plan as it's implemented.
Ruth McGuire.
I thank the Minister for that action. HRT is part of the jigsaw of management of menopause, and for many women it provides invaluable relief from the quite debilitating symptoms of menopause. Those women will be concerned about reported shortages of HRT. Can I ask the Minister what this current situation is in Scotland, and further to that, if she would consider enabling pharmacists to prescribe HRT so that where there are shortages, women can be advised on and provided with an alternative at the time rather than returning to their GP?
Minister.
I'm grateful for that question. Community pharmacists in Scotland are able to make appropriate generic or branded substitutions by endorsing for a change of strength or quantity if alternative products are available. Pharmacists who are independent prescribers can prescribe items within their clinical competency, and we're committed to expand the number of community pharmacists undertaking independent prescribing qualifications and have invested in a programme to support this. In addition, serious shortage protocols, SSPs, which can apply to the whole of the UK, which do apply to the whole of the UK, are used for serious shortages when medicines are likely to be unavailable for some time. So three SSPs were introduced across the UK on the 29th of April 2022. Community pharmacists can limit the supply to 3 months in accordance with the SSP for eligible patients to help conserve stock and to ensure that as many patients as possible are able to have access to their prescribed medicine.
A supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and this question is a similar vein to the previous one. Across Scotland, many women are struggling to access hormone replacement therapy due to complex issues in the supply chain. While these shortages are the product largely of increased demand, it's unacceptable that many women are experiencing severe comfort and anxiety as a result of this. It is welcome that the UK Government has established an HRT task force to get to the bottom of these issues, but what work is the Scottish Government doing to ensure that the short and long-term supply of HRT can meet the rising demand in the future? And can the Minister confirm whether the Scottish Government is working with the Scottish Medicines Consortium, health boards and community pharmacies to improve the flow of medicine between suppliers, wholesalers and pharmacies?
Minister.
So the member is absolutely correct that these problems are affecting the whole of the UK. The member will also be aware that the supply of medicines is a reserved matter for the UK Government. But Scottish Government officials and NHS National Procurement colleagues are regularly updated on any supply disruptions which might arise and provide advice to the NHS in Scotland on options to address the shortages. The disruptions in the availability of HRT are very concerning to those who have been prescribed them, and anyone affected by the disruption should discuss alternative treatment options with their doctor in the first place. Undoubtedly, these arise because of complex issues. There is indeed a rise in demand, but there are also other factors which are contributing to the shortages of HRT at the moment. We welcome the appointment of Madeleine McTernan as the HRT SAR. We will absolutely work together with the UK Government in order to improve the situation on this really important matter. We'll make sure that information from Scotland is taken into account, and my officials have already been in contact with the Department of Health and Social Care to work alongside Ms McTernan.
Before I call the next question, I would really make a plea for succinct questions and succinct answers. Otherwise, I will simply not be able to call all the questions. Question number six, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what recent assessment it has made of the number of people requiring home care but who remain on waiting lists for such care.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is aware that there are significant pressures facing the social care sector at present, including high levels of unmet need, and the situation is under constant review. The cross-sectoral adult social care GOLD group meets fortnightly, providing strategic national oversight on system pressures alongside key partners. The Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and I also have frequent meetings with local areas facing the most acute social care pressures, with discussion focused on solutions.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? More than 500 people died last year while waiting for home care. There are over 5,000 people waiting to be assessed. 404 of those are in South Lanarkshire. Age Scotland described these figures as an absolute tragedy, and it's a fact that the longer people languish on these lists, the quicker they deteriorate. So what urgent steps is the Minister going to take now to get on top of this crisis?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government has encouraged and supported partnership working between local resilience groups and health and social care partnerships in order to get this right. Through contact with partnerships, I'm aware that there are a range of local initiatives across the country using volunteers, redeployed staff and third sector partners to support recipients of care. And a lot of work is going on in that regard. Also, in terms of our discussions, the Cabinet Secretary and I are ensuring that best practice is exported across the country. But I think, Presiding Officer, we have to recognise that although things are improving, we have had a significant problem with staffing shortages because of folk being off with COVID-19. That is improving, and thank goodness for that. But also, in terms of that social care workforce, we would be doing so much better if we had managed to retain the staff who have returned home to their home countries because of Brexit and the Tory government's hostile environment towards immigration.
Question number seven, Natalie Dawn, who's joining us remotely. Ms Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government to provide an update on whether adult disability day centres are able to operate at pre-pandemic levels.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recognise the importance of day services to both those who use them and to their families and carers. Decisions about individual services are made by local authorities, but it is important that such services resume given the benefits that they bring to people, the current low risk to public health and the mitigations that can be put in place without hampering operations. Last year, I wrote to local authorities emphasising the importance of day services, asking them to look at reopening services in line with COVID-19 guidance as soon as possible. I can also say that further to a recent meeting with representatives of unpaid carers, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care has undertaken to write to COSLA to ask for an audit of adult daycare and respite services in every local authority, with a view to finding out which services have reopened and which have only partially opened or opened with reduced capacity.
Natalie Dawn.
Thank the Minister for that answer. In my constituency, it appears that the local health and social care partnership are not certain on how the guidance applies to the reopening of their adult day care centres to pre-pandemic levels. Whilst organisations such as Capability Scotland have reopened their centres to pre-pandemic levels, this has not happened in local authority-run adult daycare centres. Would the Minister be able to clarify the guidance which day centre operators are to adhere to? Or if the Minister wishes to respond to that point in writing, I would be most grateful.
Minister.
In response to Natalie Dawn on that particular point around about the guidance in Renfrewshire being uncertain, I would ask that Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership engage with my officials on that point, and we will help in that regard. It is absolutely vital that services return to a new normal, recognising that there is improved infection prevention across society. Of course, COVID-19 still remains a concern for public health, so it is recommended that folks follow the current Public Health Scotland guidance. But I would reiterate my point, if there is any dubiety about that guidance, Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership are free to contact my officials or Public Health Scotland to get clarity.
Thank you, Minister. We have now run out of time, so I will have to draw portfolio questions on health and social care to a close. And there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio questions, which will be social justice, housing and local government. Thank you.
The next portfolio is Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and at question number one, I call Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what discussions the Social Justice Secretary has had with the Transport Minister regarding the possibility of extending free bus travel in Scotland to people seeking asylum.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
So, asylum seekers in Scotland are already able to access the national free bus travel schemes for older and disabled people and, of course, under 22s. The Minister for Transport and I are keen that we do what we can to support all asylum seekers in Scotland, including enabling them to access support and services on the same basis as other residents in Scotland, and this includes providing free bus travel to other asylum seekers. We're doing this whilst needing to bear in mind the UK government's reserve policy, which unfortunately restricts access to support.
Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? I mean, it's really clear that free bus travel for under 22s has been transformative for hundreds of thousands of young people. But of course, the cost of living crisis is going to hit all those seeking asylum, especially given that they're forced to live on just over £40 a week and are actually banned from working as well. I mean, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that now is the time to take that decisive practical action to counter the hostile environment agenda peddled by the Tories? Will she commit to meet with me and other interested parties to unpick some of the barriers that she just explained to expanding free bus travel to all those seeking asylum in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm certainly happy to agree to meet with Mark Ruskell to discuss this in more depth. He will be aware of the Ending Destitution Together strategy, which really sets out a clear approach to improve support for people subject to no recourse to public fund restrictions, including people seeking asylum. What I can say that is that Scottish Government officials are investigating the case for providing free bus travel to those asylum seekers who do not meet the criteria for the existing schemes. And of course, happy to update you on progress in due course, either at the meeting or I would write to the member.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank the Cabinet Secretary for her responses so far. I have thanked the Cabinet Secretary for having met with me and also thank the Transport Minister for having met me on this issue previously. and she recognised that it would cost less than £400,000 a year. In terms of impact versus cost, this is an extremely good initiative. And if there's such a hold-up, can the Cabinet Secretary please give an indication of what sort of timescale we could be facing to get this introduced? Because people are facing this destitution on a day-to-day basis. It really is a serious hardship faced by a lot of people in our community.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, can I recognise Paul Sweeney's interest in this issue? And he's asked me a number of questions about this in his campaign on it quite hard. And obviously we met and had a very constructive meeting. We are, as I said in my answer to Mark Ruskell, actively looking at the moment of what can be done. Well, obviously, we need to bear in mind the restrictions of no recourse to public funds. However, we are keen to do what we can around the issue of transportation. I know that certainly one local authority has already made some progress in this area, and well, it's Stirling Council, indeed, that has used some of its Home Office funding to support resettlement, to buy bus passes for some Syrian and Afghan families covered by the UK government resettlement schemes. And I think they're extending that to Ukrainian refugees as well. So I think what I would want to do is work, obviously officials are working on this. I want to pick up that conversation more broadly with COSLA once we have the new team in place, but happy to keep Paul Sweeney appraised of progress, because I know he has an active interest in this matter.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The recent crises in Afghanistan and Ukraine have put Scotland's new Scots refugee integration strategy to the test. Can the Cabinet Secretary underline the ways in which the new Scots approach offers compassionate support and opportunities to displaced people despite the scale of these challenges?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I can. The new Scots refugee integration strategy provides a clear framework for all those working towards refugee integration in Scotland, with the key principle that integration begins from day one of arrival. It assists partners to make the best use of resources and expertise by promoting partnership approaches, joined-up working and early intervention. It provides a strong foundation to respond to challenges faced by refugees, asylum seekers, displaced people and communities across Scotland, and it aims to support people to use and share their skills, culture and experience as they begin to rebuild their lives.
Thank you. Question number two, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the delivery of affordable housing.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the latest statistics show that since 2007, this government has delivered 108,106 affordable homes, with over 75,000 of these being for social rent, including 17,681 council homes, which is a record to be very proud of. As is our commitment to deliver 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, 70% of which will be for social rent, and 10% in remote, rural and island areas. And of course, we have a £3.6 billion planned investment in this Parliament term to allow the important work of ensuring that everyone in Scotland has a warm, safe and affordable place to live.
Willie Coffey.
And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I've seen promising signs of affordable house building getting back into full swing in my own area, with over 1,500 low-cost and social homes now built by the SNP in East Ayrshire since 2007. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the house building sector is on track to a full recovery following the pandemic, putting Scotland in a good position to achieve its ambition of a further 100,000 plus affordable homes across the country by 2032?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, of course, the pandemic took its toll, and we are aware that the pace of delivery has also been affected by global issues around materials and skilled labour, supply shortages and associated rising costs. However, I'm pleased to say that the affordable housing sector is showing signs of recovery, with completions having risen by 35% compared to the previous year to December 2020. I would also say that in East Ayrshire, there is going to be available up to £66.5 million over the next 5 years, which is a 25% increase on the previous 5 years, something which I'm sure the member will welcome.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If the Cabinet Secretary is proud of her record, can she explain to Parliament why, after 15 years of this SNP government, do we see a record number of children living in unsuitable temporary accommodation in Scotland? And what plan does the Scottish Government have to end that practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we are working extremely hard to end the use of temporary accommodation. an estimated 2,100 households with children have been helped into affordable housing in the year to the March 2021. And of course, we did reintroduce the Council House Building Programme, the first such central government support to councils in a generation, in marked contrast to the 500,000 council houses sold off under the Tories. 500,000 council houses sold off under the Tories, which is a lot of homes to have to make up. And it doesn't stop here, because here is an article from the Telegraph, of all places, showing that Boris Johnson is leading the charge to sell off housing association homes. So not content to sell off council homes, they now want to sell off housing association homes. Affordable housing is only safe under this SNP government.
Question number three, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I remind members of I'm in heat of PIP to ask the Scottish Government how many people it estimates will qualify for an indefinite award within the first 12 months of the national launch of adult disability payment.
Minister Ben McPherson.
President Officer, our policy on indefinite awards will avoid unnecessary reviews for severely disabled people with needs that are highly unlikely to change. This approach will provide dignity, will be proportionate to people's needs, and will provide the security of long-term financial support. Our approach is supported by disabled people. Furthermore, the decision-making process for adult disability payment will be person-centred and compassionate to meet the needs of the individual. Therefore, the number of awards will of course depend on the circumstances of those that apply. The Scottish Fiscal Commission is responsible for forecasting adult disability payment, and our policy on indefinite awards will be part of their next forecast.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, President. I'm slightly surprised by the Minister's answer. In that, firstly, I only asked for an estimate, so a rough idea would have been helpful. And secondly, how will an individual who applies and gets a lower rate from a higher rate then be able to have that reviewed if it's indefinite? Because the condition may get worse, but they may not know that. Will the new Social Security system allow for the department to do reviews so that it can benefit the claimant and not take away?
Minister.
First of all, I presume there's implicit praise for the Scottish Government's position from Mr Balfour, as there has been across the UK on this issue. He does raise some important points. I'd be happy to have further discussion with him on this. Just to come to the point, of course, we're in a period at the moment of the launch of adult disability payment. And then we will undertake case transfer. So people can apply in the first phase of a disability payment pilot for indefinite awards now. And then as part of the case transfer process, when people have their review after they've been transferred, they will be able to apply for an indefinite award at that juncture. In terms of if people are on a lower rate of mobility but feel that they should be on a higher rate, the point of indefinite awards at the moment, we're only awarding them at the higher rate, but we continue to engage with stakeholders on potential indefinite awards for those on lower rate in due course. That is a point of further consideration. But also, and I think this is an important point, if we are very cognisant of the point that Mr Balfour raises about if people feel that their conditions have changed, they should be able to then provoke a review in order to seek potential higher support if they think they're eligible for it. So these are all being considered as they should be, and I'd be happy to pick it up with Mr Balfour further if that would be of assistance.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I registered an interest as someone who is in receipt of personal independence payment. The Minister for Disabled People, Chloe Smith, has confirmed that it will be for the DWP to determine who is eligible for passported benefits should the Scottish Government wish to implement different eligibility for adult disability payment, and has asked for notice of intentions around this. Can the Minister confirm whether it is his intention to change eligibility for adult disability payment, including to get rid of the 20-metre rule, and has he indicated such to the Department of Work and Pensions?
Minister.
It's not entirely relevant to the question of indefinite awards. Ms Duncan-Glancy is very well aware of the engagement that we've had both with the committee and with the UK Government on adult disability payment and the eligibility criteria for it. As Pam Duncan-Glancy knows, we have committed to a review of adult disability payment commencing later this year and into next year, and eligibility criteria will of course be assessed as part of that independent review, and we will consider matters including passporting going forward from that.
Thank you. Question number 4, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how the action set out in its Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan will support low-income families in Stirling.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robson.
Our second Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, Best Start, Bright Futures, sets out how we will provide immediate financial support to families and break the cycle of child poverty. We will increase the Scottish Child Payment to £25 by the end of 2022, having doubled it to £20 per week from last month. And of course, we've committed to mitigate the UK government benefit cap as fully as possible within devolved powers. We'll also help parents to work and earn more through increased investment of up to £81 million this year in a new parental employability offer and transition fund.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Increasing the Scottish Child Payment and mitigating the UK government's cruel benefit cap are hugely welcome, but does the Cabinet Secretary share my frustration that policies like the Scottish Child Payment are undermined by the UK Government welfare changes, including the cut to Universal Credit, and that we could go so much further in realising our ambitions in tackling child poverty if we didn't have to mitigate actions taken by Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I totally agree with Evelyn Tweed on that point. It is incredibly frustrating. The devastating impact of successive UK government welfare cuts imposed since 2015, including the two-child limit, the removal of the £20 universal credit uplift, and the 2015 to 2020 benefit freeze, among others, if they were reversed, an additional £780 million would be getting into the pockets of Scottish households. Importantly, this would lift 70,000 people, including 30,000 children, out of poverty in 2023-24. Despite this, we will continue to provide support to low-income families that is unparalleled in the UK, including increasing our Scottish Child Payment and taking further action to mitigate the impact of Westminster policies, including the benefit cap, as we do already for the bedroom tax.
Question number 5, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what duty local authorities have to assist disabled people who reside in mobile or park homes under the Chronically Sick and Disabled Persons Scotland Act 1972.
Cabinet Secretary.
We want disabled people in Scotland to have choice, dignity and freedom to access suitable homes built or adapted to enable them to participate as full and equal citizens. Local authorities have powers and duties under a range of legislation, including the Chronically Sick and Disabled Persons Scotland Act, to assess an individual's care needs and to provide support services as required. Support offered should be based on the assessment of the person's particular needs and taken account of their preferences, and should not be affected by the type of property that they live in.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. The Cabinet Secretary may be aware that many mobile or park homes disabled residents are denied adaptations by local councils who cite the temporary nature of their homes. How best can this widely held position be countered so that disabled residents receive the support to which they should be entitled?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Colin Beattie raises a very important matter here. And as I said, everyone should have access to the support they need to be able to live in a home which is suitable for them. Now, we know that the adaptation system requires improvement, and we're currently undertaking a review that will improve, streamline and accelerate the adaptation systems. The review will consider issues relating to adaptations to park and mobile homes, and this will ensure that access to adaptations is fair and equitable, regardless of property type or tenure, and remove any inconsistencies.
Thank you. Question number 6, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to families in the Cowdenbeath constituency that may be at risk of poverty due to the cost of living crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
Through our second Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, we have set out bold action to drive forward progress across the country on our national mission to tackle child poverty. We are set to invest almost £770 million to tackle the cost of living crisis this year. By the end of this year, our five family benefits will be worth a maximum of over £10,000 by the time an eligible family's first child turns six, and over £9,700 for every subsequent child. That is £8,200 more than is available for children in England and Wales. Our Scottish Child Payment will lift an estimated 50,000 children out of relative poverty in 2023-24.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer and indeed welcome the various measures that the Scottish Government is putting in place to help my Cowdenbeath constituents. But given that so many people face acute financial hardship, surely, Cabinet Secretary, it should be all hands on deck. And is it not the case in that regard that Scottish Government interventions are in fact being undermined by the failure of the UK Chancellor, who regrettably still holds the key economic levers in Scotland? So for the UK Chancellor's failure to step up and treat this crisis with the urgency required.
Cabinet Secretary.
Annabel Ewing is absolutely correct, and wouldn't it be better if we were all facing in the same direction on child poverty? The UK Government, as the First Minister said during FMQs, has failed to act or even understand the pressures that households are facing. We have repeatedly urged them to take more action to support hard-pressed households, including cutting VAT on household energy bills, taxing companies on excess profits, and to match the 6% uprating that we delivered for eight of our social security benefits. But they have failed to do so. The Scottish Government will continue to do what we can, but wouldn't it be better if the UK Government was to do the same?
Question number seven, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is giving to local authorities for expanding the provision of sites for Roma or traveller communities and reducing time on waiting lists.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is providing up to £20 million to local authorities between 2021 and 2026 through the Gypsy Traveller Accommodation Fund for more and better accommodation. The second round of this fund opened on the 31st of March, and we have asked for proposals for projects which increase accommodation across councils who have identified the need for more pitches or a new site. And we are also commissioning research during 2022-23 to make it easier for local authorities to identify and plan for unmet accommodation needs. And these actions will support our work in reducing waiting lists.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Clintity Travellers site in Aberdeen is already at capacity, and though the redevelopment plans are much needed and welcomed, the improvements will not increase capacity or tackle waiting lists. Will the Scottish Government consider implementing statutory reporting on delivery plans, site provision and waiting list actions so that a fuller picture can be provided of the needs of this community? And can the Scottish Government do more to recognise ancestral stopping sites that might help address some of the issues this community faces?
Minister.
Can I thank Maggie Chapman for this incredibly important question? There is already a range of obligations on local authorities to plan and report on Gypsy Traveller provision, including requirements in the Planning Scotland Act 2019 through local housing strategies and housing needs and demands assessments, and there's annual reporting to the Scottish Housing Regulator. If Maggie Chapman has other ideas on how we could do more of this, I'd be very happy to meet with her and discuss those. But we also have in our joint action plan with COSLA, which includes an action to map traditional stopping places, which is still being progressed as we speak. And in relation to capacity at the Clintity site, Aberdeen City Council anticipates the capacity will increase from 21 to 38 caravans while complying with fire safety regulations. And I'm also happy to discuss these points further and mark the progress if Maggie Chapman should wish that.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank the Minister for our update on the progress being made towards the Gypsy Traveller sites and new sites towards housing to 2040 in line with the 2019 Action Plan. In my committee, we heard evidence from COSLA that Gypsy Traveller sites had been deemed not suitable accommodation under the Homes for Ukraine scheme. Can the Minister give any indication that Gypsy Travellers here and also those coming from the Ukraine will be supported in appropriate accommodation? And what can the Scottish Government do to ensure that there's no discrimination in that process?
Minister.
Okay, a couple of questions in that Presiding Officer, we've provided £2 million in 2021 for councils to make immediate improvements on public sites based on what their residents said they needed, and all 19 councils with Gypsy Traveller sites received that allocation. The Gypsy Traveller community, when I met with them a few weeks ago, I have community conversations with them very regularly. They raised the issue around about the Homes for Ukraine scheme, and I have raised that directly with the Minister responsible, so I'll write back to Claire Adamson with the response to that. But can I also just say that through the first funding round of our accommodation fund, just over £1 million was provided to three local authorities for specific projects. Final allocations to those projects will be agreed 22-23 and paid, and the projects in Aberdeen City, Clackmannanshire and five councils will provide accommodation that better meets the needs of residents, including larger pitches. The design, planning and procurement as well progressed in all of these, and the work will start in the sites this year. But on the point about the Homes for Ukraine, I'll come back to Claire Adamson on that.
Thank you. Question number 8, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And for a final time, can I refer to my register of interests as a serving East Lothian councillor to ask the Scottish Government how it works with East Lothian Council in the delivery of local government services across the area?
Minister Ben McPherson.
As Mr Hoy will know, as an elected councillor, at least for a short while yet, local authorities are independent entities with their own powers and responsibilities, and it is for councils to decide how they manage day-to-day service delivery and decision-making processes, albeit within statutory limits and boundaries. However, maintaining a close, constructive partnership with local government has and always will be a priority for this government. This partnership approach is underpinned by regular meetings with councils and COSLA to understand their needs so that we can respond and support them accordingly. A range of portfolio cabinet secretaries and ministers and officials also have regular contact on key shared priorities with individual local authorities, including East Lothian.
Pre-coy.
But doesn't the minister accept that cash is key? And no matter how hard the government tries to spin it, we only need to look at the figures to see what they really think of our councils. In East Lothian, the SNP cut the council's core funding by £3 million in real terms in this year alone. So in what way is slashing East Lothian's budget, while saddling the council with spending commitments for SNP policies, anything other than a cynical cash grab by centralising SNP ministers?
Minister.
I won't repeat what the First Minister stated at First Minister's questions earlier, except to emphasise that the Scottish Government has had a real terms reduction of 5.2%, whereas in our allocation to local authorities, there has been a 6.3% real terms increase compared to 21-22. And the figures for East Lothian, they will receive £213.3 million to fund local services this financial year, which equates to an extra £19.4 million to support vital day-to-day services, or an additional 10% compared with 21-22. And in addition, all councils will receive their fair share of the currently under-distributed sum of £93.9 million. So I think it's important that we consider the wider context. Also, initiatives that the Scottish Government are taking, for example, the Scottish Child Payment, which are all additional supports for communities across the country. And just in concluding, Presiding Officer, may I take this opportunity on behalf of the Scottish Government to thank all those who are retiring councillors for their public service.
Thank you. That concludes this portfolio. There'll be a brief pause before we begin Constitution, External Affairs and Culture.
Thank you. The next portfolio of questions is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And again, those who would wish to ask a supplementary question should press their request to speak button during the relevant question or enter R in the chat function during the relevant question. And again, succinct questions and answers would always be helpful to allow me to take all questions on the business bulletin. And I call question number one, Pam Duncan-Glancy, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions on the Constitution Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding support for people with no recourse to public funds to access financial support.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robson.
The Scottish Government and COSLA are working to deliver our joint Ending Destitution Together strategy published in March 2021 to improve and strengthen support and provision for people who are subject to no recourse to public funds living in Scotland. The pioneering strategy is the first of its kind in the UK and is being delivered in partnership with third sector, public services and local authorities over the next 2 years. The Scottish Government is providing £250,000 to support a Scottish crisis fund coordinated by the British Red Cross up to June 2022. And this fund provides grants to people facing destitution who are experiencing barriers to accessing support.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Over the past 6 months, hundreds of people with no recourse to public funds have been supported with emergency cash through Scottish Crisis Fund delivered by the British Red Cross. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the fund is currently a pilot and that whilst there is a welcome work from a number of charities supporting refugees and asylum seekers at risk of destitution, getting money to people is one of the most effective ways to provide short-term help. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that cash payments must be at the heart of tackling destitution, and will she commit to expanding the reach of the Scottish Crisis Fund to ensure this lifeline can reach everyone, such as people like Ukrainians currently on seasonal work visas at risk of being made destitute?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Pam Duncan-Glancy makes some important points around the Scottish Crisis Fund. It was obviously important in providing emergency grants, but also to capture data to improve our understanding of where and why destitution is occurring to inform our longer-term approach. The Scottish Government will be reviewing the data provided by the British Red Cross to help inform the next steps, and I'm happy to write to Pam Duncan-Glancy with that further update.
And supplementary, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. Will the Scottish Government outline what actions it and COSLA are taking via the Strategic Migration Partnership to safeguard mental health and wellbeing amongst people with no recourse to public funds?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Ending Destitution Together strategy includes an action to improve access to mental health services for people subject to no recourse to public funds by working to better understand the barriers to access and then collectively agree practical actions that can be taken. The Scottish Government provided £223,000 funding to the Simon Community Scotland and Safe in Scotland in 2021-22 to boost the direct practical support they provide to meet the mental wellbeing needs of people with no recourse to public funds in Glasgow and Edinburgh, many of whom have PTSD or similar conditions related to the reasons that caused them to leave their home country.
Question number two, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the potential impact on Scotland of the outcome of the French presidential election.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I take the opportunity to repeat the congratulations of the Scottish Government and no doubt members right across this chamber on the re-election of President Emmanuel Macron for a second term. This result creates the opportunity for the Scottish Government, particularly through our office in Paris, to continue our collaborative work with the French Government on shared issues, issues such as culture, as climate change, biodiversity, human rights and many others, also creating the opportunity to reaffirm our shared and strongly held European values.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Voters in France have recently joined those in a number of European countries by rejecting the far right with the dismissal of Marine Le Pen at the ballot box. What assurances can the Cabinet Secretary make to ensure that Scotland's politics will also remain internationalist and free of hate?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government's approach to international engagement is built on the same values of fairness and inclusion that guide our policies at home, our international activities and domestic priorities are mutually reinforcing by offering our expertise and making a constructive contribution to addressing global challenges, we can continue to promote Scotland as a good global citizen, and at the same time, our international work and our engagement informs the achievement of our domestic objectives, for instance, by advancing a just transition to a net zero, nature-positive, well-being economy.
Question number three, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Culture Minister has had with the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings regarding work to install energy efficiency measures in cultural and heritage buildings.
Minister Neil Cree.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is working with stakeholders, including Historic Environment Scotland, to develop approaches and solutions to decarbonise Scotland's historic buildings while respecting and preserving the special characteristics of our buildings and place. While I haven't met with Mr Harvey on this issue specifically, the Scottish Ministers take collective responsibility for all decisions reached by the Scottish Government and will continue to do so. And this includes on our commitment that all buildings reach a good level of energy efficiency where technically feasible and cost-effective by 2033.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Evidence taken at committee points to the fact that there has been no assessment of costs for retrofitting buildings. Will the Scottish Government commit to supporting the cultural and heritage sector making such an assessment?
Minister.
So, as I've just outlined, the Scottish Government has a commitment that all buildings reach a good level of energy efficiency where technically feasible and cost-effective by 2033. And I know Historic Environment Scotland and others are doing a fantastic amount of work. I've recently visited the engine shed in Stirling, which provides a huge amount of research support and training support for people carrying out work on our historic buildings, and also to Holyrood Park Lodge, just around the corner, in terms of some of that retrofit work, which I'd encourage Mr Golden to visit both, so you can see the work that's going on to encourage the work in this space.
And supplementary, Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, in Edinburgh we have many historic buildings and sites which are faced with a twin impact of COVID and now rocketing energy prices. So can you actually say what additional funding to mitigate the impact of climate change and install energy efficiency measures will be given by the Scottish Government to ensure those buildings are kept fit for purpose for the future?
Minister.
So the Scottish Government supports historic buildings and monuments through the work of our lead public body, Historic Environment Scotland, and this includes providing £14.5 million annually for grant schemes which enable the repair and revitalisation of the historic environment. And we are currently providing substantial free advice and supporting, offering targeted support to our SMEs as well to uptake energy efficiency measures and zero emission heating through Business Energy Scotland support service delivered by the Energy Savings Trust. If there are specific issues that Sarah Boyack has in terms of specific buildings that she's concerned about, then I'd be happy to hear that, to see that in writing and to respond appropriately.
Question number four, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting Historic Environment Scotland to deliver its inspection programme and related remedial works on the condition of and impact of climate change on heritage sites.
Minister Neil Cray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the current financial year, the Scottish Government will provide £70.1 million to support Historic Environment Scotland, maintaining our enhanced support given the impact of the pandemic on its commercial income. Historic Environment Scotland's inspection programme, designed to assess the condition and the impact of climate change on some of Scotland's most significant heritage sites, is already underway, and I continue to engage regularly with Historic Environment Scotland to discuss the progress of these inspections and the current and future outlook for our heritage sites.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. So the Minister will know that a number of heritage sites are currently closed across my region of Mid Scotland and Fife. These castles and sites are vital for attracting visitors and tourists, not least due to the Outlander connection that we have. So there's a couple of questions. How is the Minister trying to quickly progress? How is he supporting Historic Environment Scotland to quickly progress the surveys? And also, I'd imagine at the end of this, there will be quite a large price tag for remedial work. He's talked about, I think, £14 million a year and £70 million. But is that going to cover the cost of the anticipated remedial work? And what discussions is he having with them to prepare for the kind of funding that's going to be required?
Minister.
Thank you. Claire Baker is fortunate in her region that she represents some 17 sites of interest in this area. And I'm sure that she would welcome the opportunity to visit some of those sites with Historic Environment Scotland to be able to see the work that's been progressed there. The closures and access restrictions are clearly regrettable, but necessary. I'm sure members will appreciate that health and safety must remain the top priority. By restricting access, Historic Environment Scotland is making sure that it does not expose visitors and his colleagues to any possible risks. And I continue to discuss the closures and restrictions regularly with Historic Environment Scotland and will continue to impress on them the need for their communication plan to provide clarity and consistency for sector stakeholders and the public as we approach the summer visiting season. The inspection, in terms of finances, the inspection programme is ongoing. Historic Environment Scotland is working hard to uncover the extent of the issues faced at all its properties in care for us to take a full assessment on terms of cost from there.
A supplementary, Fiona Hislop.
Can I thank the Minister for accompanying me on the recent site visit hosted by Historic Environment Scotland to Linlithgow Palace in my constituency to hear about and see the extent of high-level masonry repairs required to ensure safe and possibly phased reopening of Linlithgow Palace, the birthplace of Mary, Queen of Scots. Tourism and businesses in the town need it to reopen to attract trade. Can the Minister commit to prioritising the timescale and funding needed to ensure Linlithgow Palace opens safely and in a timely manner?
Minister.
Yes, of course. And I thank Fiona Hislop for her invite and for her allowing me the opportunity to be able to see at much closer inspection the Linlithgow Palace. The condition of Linlithgow Palace in March and the risk of falling masonry that it poses to visitors and staff, it brought home, I think, to both of us the impact of accelerating climate change on our historic environment. I would encourage members, again, who have properties in care in their constituency or region which are affected by access restrictions to arrange a site visit with Historic Environment Scotland, speak to its conservation experts. These access restrictions remain unfortunate and frustrating for us all, but there are compelling reasons behind why they are necessary at this time, and I'm keen that the inspection surveys are carried out as quickly as possible to re-establish access for visitors to our precious historic sites.
Question number 5, Annie Wells, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what work it's doing to support the revival of cultural and heritage institutions in Glasgow City Centre in the aftermath of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the course of the pandemic, the Scottish Government has announced £256 million of support to the culture, creative, heritage and events sectors. This includes a £20.8 million fund administered by Creative Scotland to support cultural organisations as a result of the Omicron restrictions. Creative Scotland will publish the recipients of their fund shortly. Three Glasgow-based culture and heritage organisations received funding under Historic Environment Scotland's Historic Environment Recovery Fund, totalling £88,900. And the Scottish Government has contributed over £7.5 million to the refurbishment of the Burrell Collection. Discussions are ongoing regarding the Scottish Government's support towards the refurbishment of the Citizens Theatre as well.
Annie Wells.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Cultural and heritage institutions will play a vital part in attracting people back into Glasgow City Centre. However, like many other organisations, they face a business rates cliff edge at the end of June. Will the Scottish Government therefore consider strategic use of rates relief to support these institutions, as has been called for by a number of leading arts organisations?
Minister.
So I'm sure Annie may also be familiar with the fact that the Scottish Government has already funded the most competitive rates regime in the UK and has gone over and above the UK's scheme in providing support to our businesses and ratepayers across Scotland. If she would have a particular proposal that she would like to pro-offer, then I'd be happy to hear it, as would government colleagues, to ensure that we are providing all necessary support to the institutions that she and I hope can recover as quickly as possible, not just from an economic perspective, but clearly from a wellbeing perspective too.
And supplementary, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's reassuring to hear the support available for cultural institutions, but it's also worth remembering that freelancers remain a vital element of Scotland's cultural sector. Can the Minister provide any update on the hardship fund for creative freelancers?
Thank you, Minister. Obviously, a wee bit wider than the actual question, but perhaps you could deal with it briefly, the question raised. Thank you.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Gillian Martin. It's an important area. I appreciate that freelancers have been particularly affected by the COVID-19 measures. The Scottish Government has most recently provided over £10 million to support freelancers in the form of two funds administered by Creative Scotland. The Cancellation Fund for Creative Freelancers made awards totalling £2.9 million, and the Hardship Fund for Creative Freelancers made awards totalling over £7.5 million, and the list of these recipients will be published shortly by Creative Scotland.
Question number 6, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it last held talks with the UK Government about devolving immigration powers to Scotland.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, President Officer. We've clearly set out how devolution of migration powers would work in our January 2020 paper. In February, I wrote a joint letter with my Welsh and Northern Irish counterparts to the UK Minister for Safe and Legal Migration, calling for immediate changes to the immigration system and for regular engagement. On the 28th of April, last week, I met the UK Minister to discuss a range of migration issues, including these. And despite this, there has been no positive response from the UK Government. It's therefore clear that only through independence and restoration of freedom of movement that we can best properly tackle Scotland's population challenges.
Rona Mackay.
I thank the Minister for that answer. My office manager and his husband have been asked by a Ukrainian family friend to sponsor their 16-year-old while his parents are trapped in the Donbass region. It's been 10 days since the application was submitted and they're still waiting on an update from the Home Office. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that powers over immigration must be devolved to Scotland so that we can waive the requirement for visas and allow refugees to get here as quickly and safely as possible?
Minister.
Thank you very much indeed, President Officer. And I really sympathise with Rona Mackay's constituents in this case. And sadly, people remain at the mercy of the Home Office visa processing arrangements. Rather than properly fund a humanitarian resettlement scheme, the Homes for Ukraine and Family schemes are characterised by significant administrative issues, complex application processes and unacceptable delays for individuals forced to flee their homeland. The UK is now in the unenviable position of being the only major European country without a legal route for unaccompanied children without a family connection, which exposes highly vulnerable children to preventable harm. I raised these points with the UK Minister for Immigration last Thursday, and while Scotland stands ready to assist within the current system, we remain of the view the UK must follow the example of the EU and waive visas for Ukrainian refugees.
Question number 7, David Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding the support, including funding for local authorities for displaced people settling in Scotland under a Ukraine family scheme.
Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. We continue to raise the need to provide the same level of critical support to all Ukrainians and their families, and crucially for parity of funding, no matter the sponsorship scheme that person is under. I've raised this repeatedly with the UK Government and raised this again with the UK Government's Minister for Refugees in a letter on the 25th of April and followed it up when I met with him last week. I know the Welsh Government's position is exactly the same as ours. I also encourage the UK Government to replicate our super sponsor approach, which will provide greater safeguarding protections. Those uniting with their families need to access health, education and support services too. Our local authorities want to support people regardless of the scheme they have arrived through, but they must receive a quality of funding to do so.
David Torrens.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Does the Minister agree with me that UK Government's approach to a crisis in Ukraine has, from the start, been too slow and piecemeal to effectively address the scale of the challenge, and that it must urgently provide what financial aid Scottish local authorities need to fully implement their support programmes for refugees and asylum seekers?
Minister.
Yes, I do. The pace of the UK Government's Ukrainian visa schemes is particularly disappointing and frustrating for hosts, and most importantly for the displaced people who are desperately seeking somewhere to settle. The bureaucratic administrative system the UK Government has put in place to respond to a humanitarian crisis is leaving many Ukrainians in perilous situations awaiting clearance. Comparable financial support must be made available to local authorities to support people who come through the family scheme. There should be no inbuilt discrimination in how displaced people arrive here. In addition, given the fragility of private sponsorship, we must be prepared to rematch people into alternative accommodation if there is a breakdown in host arrangements. This will also incur additional costs, and we must ensure appropriate funding is in place to support this. Our local authorities want and need to provide the same level of critical support, regardless of the scheme Ukrainians arrive through, and I have repeatedly urged the UK Government to provide that parity of funding across family and support sponsorship schemes, as has the Welsh Government, and I will continue to do so.
A supplementary, Fazil Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One problem we repeatedly hear that refugees are facing, not just those from Ukraine, but from the experience of Afghan and Syrian refugees too, is a lack of translation and interpretation resources, which can be a huge roadblock to setting into the new country. What more can the Scottish Government do to ensure that these resources are available to the refugees we welcome into Scotland?
Minister.
I thank Fazil Chowdhury for that important question. I'm very grateful to the Ukrainian community in Scotland who are stepping up on a voluntary basis to support translation services. I don't have a responsibility in terms of the Afghan or the Syrian schemes, but I know that the Scottish Government commitment to support people, regardless of where they come from, is clear. And if Fazil Chowdhury would require further detail on that, I'd be more than happy to provide it in writing.
And supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, given Home Office figures show only 20% of those who hold visas under the Homes for Ukraine scheme have made it to the UK, will the Scottish Government renew their calls to the UK Government to waive visa requirements for all Ukrainian refugees across Scotland and the rest of the UK? Because, frankly, 2 out of 10 just is not good enough.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And yes, I absolutely agree with Stephanie Callaghan. She's absolutely right to raise the concern that I very much share, which is that the slow pace of visa processing has meant that there has been problems in people getting here, and having the visas translate into arrivals is a major concern of mine. So I remain very frustrated at the pace of the UK Government's visa schemes. We now see the consequences of this decision in reports of hundreds of people abandoning their efforts to come to the UK altogether. Yet we know households across the UK want to welcome displaced Ukrainians to the UK and provide them with a place of safety in our communities. I raised these points with the UK Minister for Immigration last Thursday, and while Scotland stands ready to assist within the current system, we remain of the EU, the UK must follow the example of the EU and waive visas for Ukrainian refugees.
Question number 8, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of its international offices.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'd be delighted to, Presiding Officer. Scotland's international network creates domestic opportunities, it attracts investment, and it ultimately benefits the people of Scotland. Our international offices use a range of both qualitative and quantitative indicators across 5 outcomes. An update on this work was provided to the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee as part of their inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work. I've recently undertaken visits to Ireland, the United States, Canada and to Germany, supported by our international offices and respective countries, visits which have demonstrated all of these priorities in action.
Absolutely. Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The Scottish Government's international offices collectively have a budget of nearly £8 million of taxpayers' money. But it was only noted in the recent report by the Constitutional, External Affairs and Culture Committee, any reports on their activities have only been available up to now in response to Freedom of Information requests. Will the Cabinet Secretary commit to publishing an annual report on the work of these offices so that future scrutiny and activities undergo the proper scrutiny within this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I first say that I would urge Alexander Stewart and all other colleagues with an interest in this area to take every opportunity to recognise the excellent work that's been undertaken on all our behalf by Scotland's representatives and Scotland's offices around the world. As I noted during my committee appearance, I was pleased to see the cross-party enthusiasm and consensus for the excellent job that Scotland's international offices do day to day. We'll respond to the committee's report in due course. I look forward to the colleagues' perhaps participation in the debate next week on this. We'll respond in due course. On the particular point, we're committed to a continuous process to make sure that the work that is undertaken by our international network is measurable, is transparent and is available to the public.
And supplementary, Alistair Allen.
Can the Cabinet Secretary elaborate on the ways in which the new Copenhagen office will assist the Scottish Government's implementation of the renewed Nordic-Baltic policy statement and promote relationships with the countries in that region?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think this is an excellent question, because our new Copenhagen office will seek to increase Scotland's economic and cultural visibility in the Nordic region, promoting cooperation around shared challenges and seizing the commercial opportunities that come with it. The office will, for instance, build on the extensive partnerships between Scotland and Nordic countries around energy transition, decarbonisation and renewable technologies. It will also expand existing cooperation on digitalisation, blue economy and the creative industries.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. I'll allow a short pause in order that front bench teams can switch positions should they wish. Thank you.